I want to thank all of you for coming. I'm Gary Samore, Director of Studies here at the Council, and this event is going to be discussing a new report produced by the Council and the Saban Center at the Brookings Institution, Restoring the Balance. This report grew out of a conversation that Martin and Richard and I had last year about the challenges that the next administration will face in the Middle East. And you're all familiar with the list of difficult and very interrelated issues, including two wars, conflicts that haven't been resolved, nuclear proliferation, terrorism, just about all the horrible things in the world have found a home in the Middle East in a way that seems to reinforce each other in a negative way. And we decided that given those challenges, it made sense to pool the intellectual resources of the Council on Foreign Relations and the Saban Center and try to produce a series of recommendations for the next administration. Overall, 15 scholars and experts from the Saban Center and the Council worked together to produce this report. And you'll see the names on the cover. We split up our group into small teams to cover six issues, Iraq, Iran, the Arab-Israeli conflict, nuclear proliferation, terrorism, and political and economic reform and development. And then to top it off, Richard Haass and Martin Indyk wrote a summary chapter that draws from those other chapters that deal in more detail with those specific issues. Let's start by talking about the title, Restoring the Balance. I'm going to ask Richard to talk a little bit about what that means in terms of the overall context of U.S. foreign policy and how the Obama administration will need to deal with the Middle East in the context of the other problems that will be on the president's plate. Richard?
Well, thanks, Gary. There it may be difficult in the sense that administrations can choose what it is they do. They can't choose what it is they inherit. And it may be a desire for various reasons to reduce the prominence or the amount of calories that the Middle East require or absorb, but it may not be something that you can fulfill. The Middle East has a way of inserting itself on foreign policy agendas, and as we say in the study, the Middle East essentially is not Las Vegas. What happens there won't stay there. And if you ignore it, it's unlikely to be, the neglect is unlikely to be in the benign form. It's likely to be quite destabilizing ultimately. So as much as the Obama administration might like to reduce the prominence of the Middle East, that may prove difficult. So that type of balance may be hard to achieve, though we could talk about it later. I do think it raises particular questions, though, for the Secretary of State, the President, and others about how they divide up their time and how much time they personally decide to devote to the Middle East and to certain aspects of it, as opposed to delegating that to others. And that is a strategic question, since in government, often your most precious resource is time and attention.
The balance that we're looking to restore there, in some ways, has been restored by the Bush administration in its last year in office. For 7 years, it essentially decided that it didn't want to be part of trying to resolve the Israeli-Palestinian problem, or as Secretary of State Colin Powell said to me when he came out on his first visit to Israel — I was still ambassador to Israel for the first 6 months of the Bush administration — he said to me, he put his hand on my arm as he is wont to do, and said, "I think we're just going to park this one for a while." And I tried to suggest that parking it on a steep hill without a handbrake wasn't going to work very well, but that was the prevailing view, and it prevailed for a long time in the Bush administration. And it was only in the last year, as the President and his Secretary of State came around to seeing the importance to American interests in the region to be trying to resolve this problem. And even though I think the president made a mistake by suggesting that peace treaty could be achieved by the end of the year, nevertheless, the effort to try to put in place a process has been, I think, to some extent successful. And therefore, the handover from the Bush administration to the Obama administration is ironically going to be very different to the handover of the Clinton administration, which devoted all 8 years to trying to resolve this problem, to the Bush administration. Because, of course, we, and I include myself in that, handed over a process that was in flames, that had failed, and in a sense, it's not surprising that the Bush administration took fright and said, we're not going to deal with this. What the Bush administration has now done this last year has been put together a fairly credible process, an architecture. Final status negotiations, the effort to rebuild Palestinian security capabilities and the Palestinian economy in the West Bank, the effort to get both sides to live up to their roadmap commitments when it comes to freezing settlement activity and on the other side, dismantling the infrastructure of terror. And on the fourth level, to engage the Arab states in the process. I think what was missing and what the report advocates is a fifth level, which is Israeli-Syrian negotiations. There, I think the Bush administration was blinded by its ideological approach and missed an opportunity to create an architecture that would have given the Palestinian effort, I think, greater success.
Richard, another area where the Bush administration has tried and failed is to stop Iran's nuclear program. What do we propose, what do you propose in this book, Obama can do differently to be successful?
Let's take a step back. It's important to recall that for several years, the Bush administration's policy towards Iran overall, including its nuclear program, was to essentially hope that regime change would solve the problem. And various forms of quote-unquote engagement, including ideas like bringing Iran into the WTO, having a dialogue with them, and so forth, were rejected on the grounds that diplomacy itself would become something of a lifeline for a regime that was seen on its last legs. And I mention this because valuable time was lost. By the time the administration realized that regime change was unlikely to be in the offing, Iran had gotten much farther down the path of its nuclear program, and also oil prices had begun to go up. So, plus Iraq, its principal adversary, was in chaos, and Saddam Hussein had been removed. So the strategic situation had dramatically shifted in Iran's favor by the time the administration basically came to the conclusion that diplomacy perhaps was the best course. We can talk about it whatever level of detail people want, but the U.S. involvement in diplomacy was largely indirect, largely through the Europeans. Offers were made to the Iranians to essentially incentivize them to stop or get out of the uranium enrichment business. In return, they were offered certain financial incentives, or basically de-sanctioning was the principal incentive, and it hasn't worked. Iran has progressed, and it's actually gotten quite far. And by the time Mr. Obama becomes president, in under 2 months now, Iran will be pretty close to having produced enough enriched uranium that could make probably a primitive device. They're farther along, based upon the IAEA report that came out the other day, than people thought. Indeed, they're farther along than we thought when we actually did a lot of the writing of this. Still, that said, we believe that diplomacy is the best path to go, because there is a chance it could work. And we believe the fact that oil prices are now one-third what they were a year ago actually increases the possibility that diplomacy could work, creates greater incentives for the Iranian leadership to find ways to reintegrate themselves into the international economy, to get out from under sanctions that are having greater traction. What we basically propose is a diplomatic package that basically tells Iran, here's what we, the international community, require of you when it comes to placing significant limits or better yet, stopping their involvement in the business of uranium enrichment. Here's all the benefits that will come your way if you were to do this, and here's all the penalties that will come your way if you refuse to do this.